this is the second session on cross-border investments. And I am Linda Tsao Yang, former U.S. ambassador and executive director to the Asian Development Bank from 1993 to 1999. And having seen firsthand the difficulties of cross-border capital flow, sharing of technology and management, I have particularly appreciation for what our moderator and the two capable speakers are going to offer. This panel is somewhat different from the first one. The first ones were the, I would say, pioneers. They started 20 years ago, 25 years ago, you know, a long history, whereby this panel's work tend to be a little younger, a little more up to date. I just want to please my speakers, you know, and moderator. You know how hard they work in order to get here, right? So I must say that the moderator, Dan Rosen, would have a much bigger job to do than I. Okay, I said, I promise I'll keep quiet afterwards. So my job is to introduce Dan, and Dan would in turn introduce our capable speakers. Dan, of course, is the co-founder and head of the China practice at the Rhodium Group. Now, anyone who's serious about cross-border investments in China, you have to read about the research that the Rhodium Group come up. They have such extensive on-the-ground true data on hand that's absolutely gems, diamonds, and gold, whatever you call them. Just absolutely fabulous. Dan, along with the other two speakers, their experience level in dealing with China, the flow of capital, management, and so on, really runs very deep. They have decades and decades of hands-on experience, particularly in Dan's Rhodium Group. Their research data, really, really from the grassroots up, macro as well as micro. And I would always like to say, also use this opportunity to thank our two speakers, particularly Dr. Wu, who came all the way from China, just landed yesterday, and changed his schedule in order to be able to make his presentation. So without much to do, I would pass it on to Dan. And of course, you all have the bios of all three of them, so I won't repeat it.
Thank you. Linda, thank you very much. It's my pleasure to be here. You could put that slide up on the screen and get started. So I'm Dan Rosen, the Rhodium Group. It's an economic research company based here in New York with an office in San Francisco as well. As the ambassador noted, we do a lot of research at Rhodium. One of the things we do a lot of research on is the relatively new flow of Chinese direct investment into the OECD world, into the United States, and also into the European Union. What you see on the screen behind us here, up on the slide, is the front page of what we call the China Investment Monitor, which is a publicly available database that we put together, tracking about 1,000 Chinese direct investments in the United States over the past decade and a half. About $50 billion of deals. That's merger and acquisition and greenfield deals, 70% of which are private. As you can see, the information on the right hand of the monitor gives you the breakdown for the cumulative period, private versus government owned, which industries it's going into. You can see it's across the board. This is not just cherry picking one or two sectors. This is one great continental sized economy with interests through across the spectrum, investing into another great continental-sized economy with assets available across the spectrum. In 2014 alone, last year alone, we tracked about $12 billion in new deal flow activity across 27 of the states. Brings us to 45 American states in total now, with some amount of Chinese direct investment to show for their effort. That was 152 deals last year, 115 of which were private in all the industry categories that we're covering. So we always have some industries that are moving a little stronger, some that are falling back in the pack. Very true right now, mostly driven by an extraordinary time of economic reform back home in China, is changing the appetite for Chinese firms as they go abroad. If you'll go to the second slide I brought with me, it'll show you the breakdown of the major sectors over the past, what do we have, six or so years that we've been tracking. So we look at the change in pattern there, and we see that whereas 6 years ago, energy was really at the front of the pack in terms of Chinese interest, as the seemingly endless appetite within China for energy raw materials drove Chinese firms out around the world, including to the United States. Today, it's much more consumer-oriented sectors that we see showing up. Information and communication technologies, that giant orange part of the bar the year before last was Dr. Wu's success in acquiring Smithfield Pork. I'm going to come back to that and talk about that in a minute. But the point is that we're at the very beginning of the story. Imagine if someone showed you China's exports to the world in 1990 and said, I think there's something going on here that's big, that's worth riding this wave, this story. And then fast forward the curve, the values, the one, two orders of magnitude growth in the amount of trade flow in and out of China over the past two decades. We're at the equivalent of 1990 for China as a global direct investor. $100 billion of total Chinese outflows a year now, $12 billion in the United States. If that sounds a lot to you, you're not in the business that our panelists here are today are. Because you could have one deal that's twice as big as every Chinese deal in America last year, the value of that. We're only at the beginning. This is going to be the new part of the U.S.-China economic relationship that defines our careers, us young ones, Linda, as we look ahead to the decade to come. Let me note, too, before turning to the panel, that there are big parts of the story which are not just about the business, but are about the politics as well. We had a Republican committee perspective earlier. We'll have a Democratic perspective later. I'm glad to report that at Rhodium next month, we're taking that map. If you can go backwards one slide to the U.S. map again there. We're taking that China Investment Monitor map, and we're going to do something a little bit provocative. We're going to take the breakdown to the congressional district level. So instead of 50 states, we will show how much investment, how many jobs in 435 U.S. congressional districts by district. And that hopefully will add even more constructively to the quality of the conversation we're having in the United States of America about the benefits and what it takes to be attractive landing Chinese firms into our economy in the years ahead. In fact, there are a whole bunch of interesting research things we're doing at Rhodium, which I hope the committee will and I will have a chance to talk about more going forward. There's more things that we want to do than we have support to do presently. So if you're interested in research as a way of framing the U.S.-China conversation, please see me afterwards. But for now, see these gentlemen here, because we don't need macroeconomic research when we have the experience of the horse's mouth, as we say in our English language, Cheng Yu, saying about what matters is what these guys are doing. We have here to talk to us about the flows that are taking place in both directions. Dr. Wu Shangzhi from CDH, one of the leading private equity companies, been very active inside China for not just a few years, but a decade and a half at least, I think, early 2000s. Full bios in the package. And we have Rick Neo from Star Corporation, obviously a very, very long history of involvement in China going back about 100 years, I think. So that's, in Chinese terms, what it means to be the new kid on the block is to just be involved in, for 100 years in the Chinese economy. Let's get started. I want to have a conversation up here as much as possible. Dr. Wu, maybe we can start with you. CDH has been a leader, I would say, in figuring out how to make direct investment happen inside China for a long while. Now you've catapulted to sort of the leaderboard in terms of successfully making complicated deals happen on the outbound side with the Smithfield transaction. So maybe you can start out with a little perspective on what's happening from where you sit. And then after that, I'll kind of ask the same question of you, Rick.
Yeah, maybe I will start to observe the early days, the flow into China as direct investment, partially from the multinational like General Motors, and the overseas Chinese, Hong Kong, Taiwan, and American Chinese. Those are the first waves into China. But people may not see the second, more interesting that we do, is how the homegrown entrepreneur get funded. Behind the funding, a lot of other pension funds, the endowments, the American money. This light lunch sitting on the table on my right is from a state pension fund, is our investor in the fund. On the other side is one of the entrepreneurs that we supported 10 years ago, now was successful. I don't know if you met Mr. Nguyen last night. He actually our second investment. So the homegrown Chinese entrepreneurs, behind their success, there is a significant foreign institution money support because the venture capital industry, the domestic funding source, wasn't quite ready. So it was because of that. We were very earlier in that wave. So from that, we have seen supported 70 early Chinese entrepreneurs. When we invest them, they were small, but now they become very big, like Mr. New, that's a $5 billion company. And the Zhonghui International, who later on bought Smithfield, is an even bigger company. It's because of that growth, and they have access to the huge Chinese consumer market. It was that they see the global ambition. You know, for example, pork. Chinese consumption of protein is pork is important. So Chinese pork market is 5 times of US for Smithfield. And that's a very important market. It was those thriving forces and the growth of the Chinese company having the access to getting the flow start reversing. So that process is what we have observed was interesting and will continue commercially and mutually beneficial.
I want to circle back to this in conversation, but I'm going to make a bold bet that the logic for Shuanghui of making the Smithfield investment, driven not so much by selling to the American market, but because that transaction helps Shuanghui be even more competitive back in the China market, I'm willing to bet there's maybe 1,000 to 5,000 American names that would have the same logic to them, that would assist a growing Chinese firm in differentiating itself from the pack back home and adding something to its competitive position that its competitors who don't leave China will not have a couple years from now. But let's circle back to that. Rick?
I would agree with that. Smithfield obviously is a leading company in the pork industry in the United States in terms of vertical integration of all of the components of the pork food chain. If you look at that food chain in China, it actually has been actually quite dissected, not really connected whatsoever. So I think the part of logic here really is to lift and move that vertical integration capability over to the domestic marketplace in China. But then going back to your original question, CV Star is a company, although a New York City headquartered global financial franchise, were founded actually in Shanghai, China in 1919, almost 100 years ago. So. Mr. Starr, at a very young age, felt that you couldn't keep ever over 1 billion people out of the global trading system. So Asia, especially China, would be part of the future. So he backpacked, left Chicago, and went to Shanghai as an entrepreneur and built this company. We founded AIG, very proud of that. And today's Starr, as a private health company, has a major franchise in 45 countries with insurance operations, and in about 7 of them, with a rapidly growing investment practice. We do a lot of cross-border private equity-like direct investments, asset management, and also financial advisory and investment banking. So we do become a very major player in this space that this panel really addresses. What we have seen is really the rise of the private sector in the recent past, as Dan's research has shown. Frankly, CDH has been a major force as part of the private sector into that space. We see a lot of diversification of industries. We see a very, very strong buy-in from the Chinese investor side of the local conditions and cultures and circumstances in the United States. I think Mr. Ni from Wenxiang was one of the really excellent examples of this new generation and future generation of Chinese investors doing business in the United States or other OECD countries. So overall, this is becoming not just a niche industry, but also a mainstream industry for financial professionals and many industries around the world. Great business to be in.
So Rick, let me follow up on that. 100 years of experience is an asset, but it also means there's higher expectations for your ability to know how to be valuable to the Chinese side than anybody else. You don't have an excuse. Other companies do. The conference today is about building bridges. Well, that's the theme here. Your business strategy, CV Stars, is to be part of the bridge for Chinese firms trying to come out. What's the most important value proposition that you guys are pitching, bringing to Chinese firms looking to develop their operations, say, in the United States? What are some of the things that are most compelling that you guys appreciate by virtue of your experience?
Great question. There was a mention of something along those lines in the morning that there has been a level of mistrust or lack of trust between the United States and China, dating back to the histories, the two different political systems, maybe some historical, ideological differences, and so forth. So trust is very important. Everything starts with that. And business and commercial activity are no exception. As a company well recognized in China, we do feel very strongly that we have gained over almost 100 years the trust of the Chinese government and the trust of the Chinese businesses and the trust of the Chinese people. When China, as a country, and many businesses were not as well noted as today, when China was nobody's child, when China was poor, we were there. The Star Foundation donated almost $250 million over the course of the last 30 years to domestic Chinese causes, not driven by profits, driven by our love for China, our deep relationship and roots in and with China. That's the starting point. So because of that, many of our Chinese friends and relationships, now very well capitalized, wanting to go global, businesses or government, really believe that we can be side by side with them. Secondly, when they go overseas, it's obvious for them to look for partners, but it's very easy for them to run across partners either overly American or maybe overly Chinese. So what do I mean by that? There are a lot of well-regarded investment banks, CPA firms, law firms, co-investors, PE firms in OECD countries. Not necessarily all of them really understand or appreciate where China comes from and many of the cultural nuances this audience here actually is very familiar with. Secondly, you have a lot of overseas Chinese that are very active in this space. Not all of them have actually made it, unfortunately, to mainstream USA or mainstream UK, and they don't really understand the dynamics of the industries and businesses in mainstream America as well. Well, CV Star has both. We have deep roots in both countries, politically, business-wise, and I think that has been a major value proposition. And lastly, if I may, to us, it's not about transactions and making money. It's really about aligning our interests with the potential investors or investees on the US side as well. It's not about making one deal, but what happens before, during, and after the transactions. I'm sure Dr. Wu will concur that deals like Shanghui, for example, is not about $7 billion in cash to return to the shareholders and that's it. It's really more about making that a viable going concern, job creator to America, lots of benefits and things to transfer over to benefit the Chinese economy as well. So there's a huge component of post-transaction integration that we think we specialize in that many of the other professional services companies or investors don't quite possess. So very proud of that.
Dr. Wu, the logic I kind of nudging you toward is this, thinking about the consumer market in China. And whereas in the finance sector, I think it's kind of the financial strategic perspective that Rick has, yours is driven by what people need to buy every week and put in their shopping cart, at least in some of the key transactions I'm most aware of, Mengniu and Shuanghui. Is it not an issue at this point that political participants in the deal on the American side, probably not so, I don't know if anybody on the Chinese side, whether there were any politics you even had to worry yourself about, But do they understand that this is just business? This is pure commerce? Or do you have to worry yourself a little bit that things can get politicized even when it's pretty clear we're talking about consumer products?
I think the consumer product is where we are strong at, because in the early days, we happened to invest in this sector. So we invest in many Chinese consumer brand names, like the dairy product, the pork product, the woman's shoe business, and the sports books. So those happen to be our early investment build up. So we only from that perspective. It's very curious to, interesting to think about the early days. We represent foreign investment. Essentially, the fund, our investors, is foreign. So when we invest in Shuanghui back then, was very similar national security review, whether the pig will be all imported from America, and that dragged along. And now the other way around. So fortunately, this sector are not that sensitive. So we got approval then. In the Smithfield case, we got approval here. Mm-hmm. So I think that is number one. I think we are not saying this is a China factory, we are gonna take job away. This is a job creation. And in this particular food related business, US, for that matter, maybe Australia, Canada, has inherent competitive advantage in the production of agriculture advantage, the feed, the land, obviously lower cost. Mm-hmm. If you have a business like Smithfield, which is integrated, you have a market there, can streamline your production of pigs and potentially more import to China, where it's a 5 times market. I think that argument to the US side should be very compelling. And for China side, we also recognize, I think Chinese recognize, you have to looking at a global comparative advantage to be globally competitive. The same thought, I mean, just using the what we gained in these Smithfield deals, in the beef side, the one person approaching us for money to invest in the cow farming in China, we said, no, let's go to Australia. We did together a deal in Australia, same thing. I think that's where the duty is going to be free for importing beef from Australia 4 years from now.
Chickens comes next.
Yeah.
We have a lot of chickens in America.
Okay. So I think that's first consumer. I can see each time you got to have all these concerns. But once you peel the onion, explain to the rationale, I think it's fine. Mm. For us, on the both country approval, both from national security and the monopolist review, we were okay.
Let me, can you put the map back up on the screen? And oh, good, they're already starting to come in. But I was gonna encourage you in the audience to be thinking about what you might like to see asked of the panelists here, because we'll have a few minutes to take your questions, and you can already start to pass them up. Just to follow up on what you were just saying, Dr. Wu, tracking of Chinese investment into the U.S., nobody actually thinks we're not getting it right, I have to say. I'm very proud of my colleagues at Rhodium for doing a pretty great job of getting the numbers as clear as you can get them anyway. We spent the past 5 months doing the preparatory work to do a companion database on current U.S. investment to China. So this would give us apples to apples in both directions. Would that be helpful, or would that stir up problems? Because then people could say, well, is there a complete reciprocity or not? Is China as open to an American agribusiness buying Shuanghui in the future as America was to Shuanghui being able to buy Smithfield? Is China ready to really do this on a sort of transparent, you know, we'll put our openness up against your openness any day basis? Or is that going to make things more complicated? Am I going to make trouble? Because I don't want to make trouble. Well, a little bit of trouble, maybe.
I personally think China is getting more and more open. I mean, if you look at the underlying reform ongoing, the current regime is current positive list approval. They will be go to negative list, already negotiated with the US and others. I think that will be open up more sectors. If you look at the contribution of, you know, American capital, if you really look at behind the private equity and the venture capital funds, I think the American capital has made tremendous contribution to the Chinese homegrown entrepreneur businesses. If you look at what listed in NASDAQ, Alibaba, Baidu, all these Chinese companies in Hong Kong, before they're going public, who support them to go there? In our fund, half is American capital, US pension funds, endowments, family offices. So those probably screened out. It wasn't looking at American strategic investment, but it was American capital.
Well, my prediction will be the same. I think although historically China hasn't been as data-driven as we here in the West, but China is increasingly more receptive to data and actually respect for data. You can look at that even from China's own GDP data reporting schemes being improved year after year, even month after month. Secondly, as all of you are aware, Chinese are among the most skilled negotiators in human history. In order for them to continue keeping that advantage, I think it would be a mistake for them not to embrace more data, because that will become a sign of weakness at the negotiating table instead of something that will make them feel that they have the advantages the other side of the table really has.
Rick, let me ask you a question. You're in the business of risk management. That's, in a word, what you guys do across the many niches that CV Star is involved in. We do more than just FDI flows. We do overall macroeconomic stability and financial stability stuff as well. There are some real concerns I have about the probability of some real financial instability in China in the years just to come. Some people look at the outflow of capital right now, and instead of seeing strength and Chinese firms that are finally willing to take their place abroad, they see capital flight and use that word. You guys are risk managers. When you get into the car for this drive of the next 10 years of your life and career working with Chinese firms, do you feel comfortable that you're able to adequately measure the risk that Chinese firms bear when they operate overseas? When they operate at home, and if they get screwed up, the government can always turn back the clock a little bit. And regulators sometimes do this and say, we're going to settle this the Chinese way. There's no use putting this through the court system. This happens in Canada or the US or Europe, and it's going to court, right? Shareholders are going to say, the managers didn't do the right thing with this iron mine up in Canada or something like that. What's your perspective as a risk manager on how ready Chinese firms are for the way these things are going to work out if there is financial distress in the near future?
Great question, Dan. First of all, risks like that exist everywhere in the world.
Yeah.
You mentioned Canada, which is an OECD G7 country, and most developed economies, including China in the future, will continue carrying that risk. I look at that less of a risk, more of an opportunity. The reason is, when you look at the history of China, it's been a very enterprising country. It's been a very entrepreneurial country. The Chinese nation has never been lacking of entrepreneurialism, no matter who's in charge or what the system really is. So the inherited openness is actually there. And this is just a modern era of Chinese economy resurging and unleashing what's been there for over 5,000 years. So I see good continuity from that cultural perspective. Secondly, the outflow itself has its own economic reasons. It's not just Premier Li says, let's go out, everybody goes out. There's a little bit of that, but fundamentally, after you have accumulated close to $4 trillion in foreign reserve, you're sitting on it, you have to be mindful of all the economic consequences, sometimes unintended as a result of that, if that money just sits there or just focus on domestic investments vis-a-vis international investment, inflation or deflation being one of the considerations. So lastly, stability in China is very important. When the GDP actually slows down in China and consumerism hasn't really taken hold to the level the policymakers and the business leaders really would like it to be, you want to find alternative ways, creative ways, sustainable ways to sustain job creation that has to amount to about 12 to 15 million a year in order for the country to avoid unrests that would not be in anybody's interest. Encouraging foreign investments, letting the entrepreneurial spirit in the minds of the Chinese people and companies really unleash to an precedent level make a lot of sense for job creation, not only here, but also in China alone. Lastly, the Chinese economy, although changing towards market principles dramatically in a favorable manner, it still has a lot of controlled components. And I think in the minds of the Chinese policymakers, opening up and reform with continuity actually are a policy that will be there forever, for a very, very long time. People use 100 years, 500 years, but very long time. In order to do so, you need external forces, not just from within China, but externally as well, to make the reform move forward. Not too dissimilar from what happened with China after it entered the World Trade Organization, which very proudly CV Star played a very instrumental role to help make happen. So you used the word reciprocity a moment ago. Historically, that's been a diplomatic term. But in commerce and global investments, when you create jobs more in the United States, when you're a major investor in the United States, treasury, direct investments, otherwise, there will be a very positive reverse effect, or converse effect, I should say, going back to China. Being more interested in China as an investee, more open to the idea of accessing the Chinese domestic marketplace, you actually ended up attracting more foreign direct investments from outside of China into China as well. So I think overall, that will remain a market principle driven and a good policy that will be sustainable for quite some time to come.
In our earlier conversation, you sort of briefly mentioned that in your research, you find a number of states in the United States, in the South, Southeastern, the Carolinas, the Tennessees, and so on. The local communities, local governments are very anxious, very interested to attract direct investments from China as a way of stimulating their domestic economy, local economy, and create jobs. Could you elaborate a little bit on that?
Sure, a little bit. I mean, you've got the map up there again. You know, you can kind of see how broadly distributed it is. You know, the United States has many different kinds of opportunities for different classes of investors. Some are willing to go right after, you know, absolute tier one brand names like Smithfield. You won't really find a better global pork brand, I don't think. Maybe, you know, Parma ham, Iberico ham, and whatnot. But it's big names. Then you have value investing in and around Detroit in the old auto sector. Somebody just handed me a question. It's a good one. How come there haven't been more deals in New York State? I think that's a good question, actually. There's a lot of sort of worn out old industrial chain assets in upper New York that I would love to see a big Chinese investor come in and do something with those assets as we talk about reshoring back into the U.S. But you know, the U.S. has everything, every conceivable way to try to add value, every strategy that a Chinese company could think of, there's a way to play that in the U.S. And the U.S. is open for business. It's demonstrating that every day. Not only in the really easy sectors, where it's obvious why there wouldn't be any political problems to make an investment, but in the semi-sensitive sectors like food, which may not be national security the way the Pentagon thinks about it, but people are sensitive about food in all countries. You know, chifan le matongzhe was the old way of asking somebody whether they're doing okay, right? Well, it goes for America too. And even in sensitive sectors like energy, biotechnology and whatnot, aerospace, there have been successful Chinese transactions. So the U.S. has a lot to offer, and China has a lot to want to invest into. I think there's a great sustainability potential to Chinese investment. Final thought on that, and I'll get back to you guys. There are today, by our count, about 100,000 Americans getting their paychecks from China-affiliated investors in America. If that seems like a big number, the number getting a paycheck from Japanese companies is closer to 800,000. So China's not even an eighth of the way to where Japan is 30 years after it did its initial investing. Many Chinese seem to think, I need to learn the lessons of what Japan did wrong. Well, yes, you should, but 95% of what Japan did, they did right in America, and they have a lot of jobs and profit show for it. Is there that historical context of the Japanese experience? Is that something you and your colleagues think about much or study much, Dr. Wu, or is everything novel when it comes to China? And so you'd be reading the wrong book if you invested your time in reading a Japan and America book.
I don't really know much about Japanese experience. I think, anyway, it is new for the Chinese company to invest in America. I don't think that is very easy. It is at the beginning of a learning curve. I think as a commercial, as an investor, shareholder of a company, you really have to be very careful and prudent to make those decisions. But when the synergy and the economic comparison, competitive advantage become so compelling, you can tolerate some of the learning and mistakes, then you are more comfortable. When you just come in here just as another guy, it would be very difficult to think the Chinese investor can do better than anybody else.
Biggest surprise so far, investing into the U.S. market for you?
No, we have only this one experience. It's a mature company. It is a well-run business. They have that's probably where a private equity fund like ourselves will start. You don't think you can do better than the locals. You have to have a strong local management team, and you have a business that add to it in China. Otherwise, for us, it is a very risky proposition to think we can do better.
Rick, any lessons learned yet, or is it too soon to say for you guys as well? Just 100 years, I mean.
Right. Thank you.
If there's one thing the Chinese are very good at, I think they excel at leapfrogging. I sometimes call this a late mover advantage. You know, in business schools in America, we always celebrate first mover advantages. In fact, when we ran AIG, we're the first in 137 countries, very proud of that. But the world has evolved. Look at the cellular phone industry in China, for example. What we here struggle with migrating, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars old infrastructure in CDMA going to LTE and 4G, trying to leapfrog directly from landline to 5G, and they're faster than us and better than us on broadband. And that's a late mover advantage. So they have, in fact, learned about the Japanese, the Korean, the South African, the Brazilian, the Australian, the British experience here in America from a business and investment experience already. For some of the new generation of leaders, whether they say it or not, they're learning about that rapidly. They know if you swallow Pebble Beach or Rockefeller Center without managing media, that will be a backlash. They learned the CNUC Unicel incident and what that entailed. People understand the Huawei situation. They understand when you bring an engine manufacturer into the Midwest, you better bring your own supplier chain along with you so that you actually create more jobs and bring a scale into a state in the U.S. for more job creation. So you will see, again, the current and next generation of Chinese investors to be a lot savvier. There's a lot of Apple fans in China, but there's one thing unquestionable about Samsung's success in America as well. And people worship the very American-style local advertisement they put on television. I have been a very loyal Apple fan myself, lived here in America for 20 years. But in terms of Korean company integration and ingraining itself in American society and becoming a truly accepted local brand, yet completely Korean at the top of the food chain, that's a prime example. It's only a matter of time before you see the Chinese enter the auto sector here in a much more mature and prominent way than early stage Japanese and Korean investors and replicate what Samsung has done in this country. So this is a great source of capital, very savvy capital. I think they'll be really a good source of investors to all of us here in this country.
Thank you, Rick. We need to finish this panel up, unfortunately. As you can see, the conversation just barely gets started. There's so much more to be said. And I would just, in summing up what I take away from what I hear, there's a powerful, powerful underlying commercial logic to this story. We have so much more opportunity as business people. There are real political issues that we haven't fully come to grips with yet that we will encounter as we see this curve of two-way flow and activity grow in the years ahead. Just as with the trade flows and the flow of people between our two countries, this is not foreordained. There's no guarantee this is going to get to its maximum potential. So much of it will depend, in fact, on many of you here in this room who have an inordinate influence on the U.S.-China relationship, and helping the rest of our countrymen as well, and women as well, understand what all this means as we have new neighbors with very big operations on our block in Main Street America and on Wall Street, of course, as well. Ambassador, do you have anything you want to say to finish us up?
Well, thank you very much, Dan, for an excellent summary. What I'm going to say a few words is somewhat different because during the last 2 days, I've been asked from many attendees about what I think about the AIIB, you know. And as a former U.S. executive director at the Asian Development Bank, they were interested in what I think. And the same in the last 2 months, I've been hearing from my former colleagues at the bank, at the ADB, saying, well, you used to represent the United States, you know, what do you think? So I'm going to say a few words, I was, as per request by some of the people here, exactly what I tell my former colleagues at ADB, yeah. And that is, good governance is a moving target. There's never a perfect standard. So every day, every week, we have to work to improve it, no matter how good it is. Back in 1993, when I first landed at ADB, the dominant Japanese management already had managed the institution for 25 years. I was shocked when I landed. One, there was no board-approved policy on governance and anti-corruption. There was no board-approved policy or even such an institution as an independent inspection function, independent of management, to make sure that bank's own employees abide by the rules and regulations of the bank itself. There was no board-approved policy on transparency and information disclosure. So whoever who happens to be near the bank get lots of advantages, quite legal, because they just, you know people, and therefore they get more opportunities for procurement, which runs to billions and billions of dollars. Okay. Resettlement. What is resettlement policy? Social. The bank itself is supposed to serve the population of Asia. Half of them happen to be women. There were 700 professional staff at the bank. Only 53 were women, and practically 95% of them were at a very, very junior level. Only one reached the highest level of so-called a management at the lowest rank. This is a situation I found after 25 years of dominant Japanese management backed by the Ministry of Finance in Tokyo. So the Clinton administration was determined that we have to make a change. The instruction from Washington to me is to work from the inside, build alliances, make constructive suggestions, okay, and work with them side by side to make changes. And after 6 years, with the help of Washington, my colleagues, and many like-minded Japanese staff as well, they were convinced in order to make the bank's assistance program more effective and productive, they one after another had board approved policies. So therefore, my answer is the same. It's a mistake for the United States not to join in the beginning. If you have any problems with it, after all, you really don't know whether there are problems because they haven't started yet. Get in there, share your expertise, and influence the people rather than standing on outside and finger pointing. And this is my opinion. I told my former colleagues at ADB, and this I'd like to share with all of you. Thank you.
Let me just tie that into the end of the panel. There are many issues of a geopolitical nature that are going to be casting a long shadow over the commercial work that these guys are doing. Please join me in thanking Dr. Wu, Mr. Niu.